Hello everyone. So I will start the presentation. So my name is Bertrand Mazius. I work at Sequoia. I will say a few words about Sequoia. Sequoia is an IT risk management company. So we do a lot of things around security. We are around threat intelligence, it's our main domain. We do some smart contract audit. We do also some pen test of applications that are aware of blockchain, like ICO portal and dApps. And we are security consultants to help our customers to implement blockchain application in their information system. So we are based in France, mainly in Paris and Rennes. We have all the business units that are focused on security, like CERT to respond to incident, security incidents. We have a blue team to defend and set up the policies to avoid incidents. And we have training centers that propose some formations about security and blockchain. So this presentation will last 20 minutes about. We'll talk about how to find contract interesting to hack with BigQuery. Then we'll see a tool that I discovered to retrieve Solidity code, it's called Erez. Then we'll explain what CFG is, and we will introduce Zen 3. Then we will see what concurrent testing is, and after to build a Z2 constraint set, and we will finish with a presentation of some tools that use Z3 internally. So about BigQuery, why I use BigQuery? In fact, to find the data about blockchain is difficult. It has a lot of friction because you have either you have the choice to have a node, for example, and you request the node through RPC, but it's very ineffective. So other way to have the data is to use BigQuery because there are nice guys that inject all the data of Ethereum in BigQuery. So you can request a lot of information like the account data, like the contract data, transaction data. And BigQuery allows complex queries. And it's a perfect tool to find some interesting contracts. So for example, I set up a query to view the constructs, the cron jewels. For example, the contracts that have the more money on them. So I sorted them by unique code, and we can see, well, we can't see very well, but for each code, we have a lot of copies of the contracts that run on the blockchain. And I computed also the cumulative balance of each code. So it gives us, for example, for the first line, that there are 36,000 copies of the same contract that run on the blockchain. And is at a total balance, cumulative balance of 3 billion Ethers. So this is something interesting to hack, because if we can find a vulnerability in this contract, we can exploit the vulnerability 36,000 times and get as a reward the 3 million Ether. The third line that is framed in yellow is a contract that holds 1 million Ether. I will show you later what is this contract. So about Erez. Erez is a tool that was presented last year at the USENIX Security Conference. It's a tool that can put in form a contract and render it in an understandable form. So what it does, it disassembles the contract, and it replaces the stack position by variables. It allows, like this, it allows to abstract the stack management. It replaces all the stores and load operations by a C notation, like say a C in bracket, with brackets, and it reconstructs the ifs and else patterns. and the loop also. So it's something that is useful to analyze contract and useful to understand what it does. What's interesting once we have the ERES analysis is to rewrite the Solidity code. So why rewrite the Solidity code? It's because ERES does not abstract the memory access and the storage access. So to make it more readable, it could be interesting to rewrite the Solidity code in a more understandable form. So this code is the Solidity code I reconstruct from ERES about the 1 million Ether contract. So it's basically a double signature wallet. Anyone can request a withdrawal, and the withdrawal must be confirmed two times by two different signers. The signer are the owners of the wallet. And interestingly, it has a vulnerability inside, a re-entrancy vulnerability that is exploitable because it's an old contract that was deployed on the blockchain in 2016. But to exploit it, you must be one of the owners of the wallet. So it didn't work. Before we go on, I will show you something. It's a spoiler. Spoiler alert, because I will show you the analysis of the Capture the Flag contest, the challenge of Baby Rivers. And this is the Baby Rivers. Sorry, it doesn't show. Yep, here. Okay, this is the Baby Rivers challenge. When we pass the contract in the analysis of ERES, it displays this. So with this, it's pretty easy to build a transaction that will exploit the contract. If you know the ABI, you could just read what value you have to put in the transaction. Okay. So, what ERES does, right, to analyze the contract, what we need to do, what ERES does, is to disassemble the contract in opcode, then to build a graph. So the graph describes the path, all the paths of the contract, all the bifurcation. Then when we have a graph, we can split the graph in different blocks. Each block represents a function of or an internal function. We have also the entry point of the contract and the default function. And for each function, we can replace the stack reference with variables. And then we can optimize the things. We can remove the variables, intermediary variables if they're not needed. So after this, we must little explain what is a control flow graph. It's a symbolic view of the program. The interest of it is that it is parsable forward or backward. So we can simulate the execution of the program. And if we add a memory model, a storage model, we can execute a program. About Z3. Z3, or as a full name, is a SMT, Satisfiability Modulo Theories. It's a solver. So basically, it takes as input some variables and function declaration as a set of constraints, and in return, a reply three types of reply. The first one is unsat. It means that there is no solution. It's a mathematical proof that there is no solution. If the reply is sat, it means that there is at least one solution, and it gives a solution. And unknown, it means that we are out of the scope of the resolution of the tree. So, for example, this is how to define the set of constraints of the tree. First, we declare the variables. The variables are declared by their perimeter, by their type. Then we define the set of constraints. The constraints are applied on the variables, and we ask the solver to give us a reply. So if we have a solution, it gives us a sat reply, and it gives a solution like this. So every part of the solution is in fact one of the variable, and the solution that it displays is A equals 0, B equals 1, and F is defined as 0 for 1 and 1 for every other value. So what's important to understand here is that this is only one solution. It can be an infinite number of solutions. Okay, now we have seen what Z3 is. The problem we have is that the EVM and Z3 use different paradigms. The EVM is an use imperative paradigm. It means that it describes how the state of the program changes. The functions are something that we are evaluating. It means that we made a computation and the result is used after. And we have a full memory and storage model. We can store some value and retrieve the value later and reuse the values. Z3 is completely different because it's declarative. We don't define how we do things. We describe the desired result. Functions and variables. Variables are functions in Z3. Functions are mathematical objects, and they are uninterpreted. It means that if in imperative, when you have a function, you compute something, you have a result. In Z3, you can't compute a result in the function of the function. You just define what is the function and the constraint of the function. And of course, there is no memory or storage model in Z3. Okay, so we are now here. The next steps are to explain concolic testing and how to build a Z3 constraint set and the tool. So here is concolic testing. What is concolic testing? So it's a complicated word to explain the thing that all the tools that do some symbolic execution do, in fact. So the input of the concolic testing is a graph, which is a description of the program in instruction. Then what we do is that we'll explore all the paths of the program to try to find a vulnerability. To start this, we must have defined what is a vulnerability. We'll see after what is a vulnerability. When we have all these paths, defined all these paths, we decline them in constraints, and the constraints are injected in the SMT solver. We ask the solver to show us a model if it exists. If there is a model, we use the model in the test input. It means an execution, a test EVM, where we can test if the solution we found can really be applied in the real world. So, how to build a path? So the path is, in fact, the path from the entry of the program to the target instruction. The target instruction is an instruction that we have defined first. It can be any instruction. So for example, we must define them. If it can't find them by itself, we must define what is a vulnerability. For example, if we have a self-destruct that it can be considered as a vulnerability. If we call a contract, like we can change the address of the contract, it can be a vulnerability. So we define the target instruction is in fact the state of the application once it has been exploited. For example, after a call, we can decide if the call was exploited or not. So when we have defined what is the target instruction, we define the path from the entry to the target, and we include all the program constraints, the assert and the require, because we must satisfy all these constraints to reach the target instruction. When we meet if then or a loop, we must duplicate the branch, because we are on the branch, we must take the branch that executes the then part of the if then else, and we have another branch that does not take this branch. So we just duplicate the branch. We unroll loop also. So if we have if we know how many iterations the loop must do, we can unroll simply the loops. But if we don't know how many iterations the loop must do, because it depends on the program state, we must duplicate a path. We must create a new path for each iteration of the loop. For example, if we have a loop, if we define that we must iterate 100 times before reaching the gas limit of the transaction, then we create a path with one iteration, a new path with two iterations, and so on until 100 iterations. So we create 100 paths for a loop. So at the end, we have a list of paths that all the paths go from the entry of the program to the target instruction. Okay. So we have a static signal assignment, which is an operation that goes from in operation to rename all the variables, because in Z3 the variables are read-only. We must resolve the problem of memory access and storage access, because we don't have memory or storage access in Z3. So the problem is in fact a key-value problem. To solve the key-value problem, we express in Z3 the fact that if the key are the same, then the value is the same, and we build a circuit between the entry, the output of the load, and the input of the store. If we have another store that in between the load and the store, then we can implicate the constraint. So there are two methods, in fact, to do a key-value access. The first method is to implicate the constraint. The second method is create a path for each store operation that we have. So if we have, for example, a path that two store operations and the load, we create a path with the first store and the load, and another path with the second store and the load. Okay, if we have called data copy, we can just define with a single instruction, in a single constraint, that there is an index, and we let the server find the index for itself. So it's just one line when we meet a data copy. And for hashing function, in fact, we don't care about the algorithm of the hash, because in Z3 we try to find a vulnerability, but we don't intend to find the vulnerability on the hash. For example, we don't intend to find a vulnerability where the hash is reversible. What we want is that just a function that is different for each. If the data is different, that the result is different. So if we have SHA-3, all we have to do is to define the constraint of unicity of the call. So we must define some constraints per by case. So ERSCAN is a program I started to do this. So it supports all this above. It's not finished, and there are a lot of work to do to make something that is usable. And a lot of, and it's pretty complicated. So the other tools that do symbolic execution and use Z3, there is a Manticore, which is the most complete tool. If you do the Solidity compiler, it has an experimentation module to detect integer overflow with Z3. It uses the same principles as I defined. There's a tool, Pacala, that does the same. It uses ClyPy to wrap Z3, but it's the same goal as what I did. And there are an alternate tool that was presented last year at USENIST Security Conference. And okay, it's a tool that promises to do a lot of things, to find vulnerabilities, double transactions, all the things that all the tools do not do. But they said that it should be released in March, and I didn't see it yet. Donc, I don't know if it will be released. Okay, so the conclusion, nothing important, except now you can hack with Z3. And this is my contact data. Okay. Do you have some questions? No questions. Okay. Okay. Can meet outside if you have some questions.